walls that were built with perpendicular walls in between. So literally she lived in a hole in the wall. And the spies go to rehab. The prostitutes house to gather information. Same way you go to the beauty salon, the nail place, and the barbershop. Come on now, yeah you do. Because you know when you get there, you're going to find out everything that's going on in the neighborhood, whether you want to or not. But while they're clipping, curl, giving you a blowout, your cornrow, your braids, and your bundles, you just might hear the latest news. Y'all missed it. Well, I'm going too fast today. You hear me come around that corner? Did I come around that corner? Did I not come around that corner? Tell your neighbor, stay woke. Stay woke. In our text, that Joshua had learned from previous mistakes. 4 decades earlier on the first reconnaissance mission, there were 10 spies that went out. The majority report says we can't do it, we can't handle it. The minority report says, yeah, we can. And sometimes you can get stuck because of the problems of possessing the problems than the promise itself. You can get so caught up in what you have to do to get through that you end up being stuck in the wilderness for 40 years. Joshua and Caleb's report was voted down by the fearful majority. And this time Joshua sent only 2 smart. And here we have Rahab, a woman that Josephus, the Jewish historian, calls an innkeeper. Tell you, baby, isn't that nice? That's a nice way of saying that, isn't it? Girlfriend is an innkeeper, She keeping it all right. Handing it out too, amen. Others refer to her as a harlot, while others call her a Canaanite prostitute who ends up in the middle of a clandestine meeting in her place of business. Rahab is way off the respectability scale of the community. Yet here she pulls back the curtain of hope with a defiant act of civil disobedience. When the news of the strangers reached the king's ears, he ordered Rahab to turn over the spies. And when Jericho's version of homeland security arrives at the hole in the wall, come on now. She said, the men are not here. I don't know where they are. Last I heard, they were going through the gates of the city. And now Rahab, when they left, goes to negotiate her safety and her security of her family. In other words, I save you, you now turn around and save me. I save your and now it's time for you to save And the spies promised to help if she hung a red cord. Y'all are on it this morning. That's all I got to say. Unless she hung a red cord in the window of her house. And you know, then the story months later, when the spies returned with the Israelite army, they kept their word, and she and her family were welcomed to this brand new community, said the writer of Hebrews, because she hid the spies by faith. And so what shall we say to these things? Turn to your neighbor, right left, say, here we go. It doesn't matter how many strikes are against you, you can reclaim your time. Sister Girlfriend had many strikes against her. She was female. She was a foreigner. She was not an Israelite. She did not have high approval ratings. Her profession was in the tank, and it was always in the tank. Could it be that Rahab was exploited, forced into prostitution, or involuntary servitude that compelled her to commit acts in order to have a roof over her head and a hole in the wall? Could it be that here we have ancient human trafficking, enslaved and caught in a life that was created for her by choice, chance, or crime? Does it really matter how she got there in the she got out? Does it really matter if she was forced into a profession as a last desperate attempt to financially support herself, or forced into business to survive and support her family by choice or chance? Many commentators indicated that this unlikely woman in an unlikely place was the first one to grasp the power of God in this foreign land. She had heard enough about God to pull back the curtain of hope, uncovering the evidence of things not seen and reclaiming her time. And so on the surface, she looks like a woman easily manipulated by men with wants and needs. But on close examination, here we have a woman with some bone in her back. This woman was no shrinking violet. She was not a recluse. She was not a weak tool in the hands of the hungry and hollering. She was reclaiming her time. Circumstances of life had devastated her potential, detoured her future, put her at the mercy of others. But girlfriend all got herself together and reclaimed the time that had been stolen for her. Here is a defiant woman who was not so afraid of homeland security that she refused to hide the spots. She was not shy about lying to the authorities. She didn't hesitate to develop a strategy. She's reclaiming her time. And she wasn't the only beneficiary. In other words, she says, if I'm getting out, the rest of y'all are coming with me. Oh, praise God for a sister who finds the way out and refuses to leave you behind. Oh, for a sister who sees the light at the end of the tunnel and say, come on, go with me. Oh, for a sister who sees the strategy, the plan, the position, the promotion, and say, I'm not gonna be elevated by myself. In the Lord's genealogy with three other unlikely women, Ruth, Tamar, and Bathsheba. Are there any unlikely women in the room? Oh yeah. Oh yeah, all of us have been unlikely somewhere along the line. They were not calling your name when the position came open. They were not reviewing your resume when they were making expansion plans. They were not looking for you, but yet God put you in a place where they cannot ignore your unique, creative, and talented self. Somewhere along the line, all of us have been unlikely. Because we were overeducated or undereducated, overqualified or unqualified, lacked experience, too much of negative experiences, or the poor decisions we made, or the ones that were made for us, the choices we made, or we failed to make, just the unlikely person, but yet we got the job, praise God, we got the promotion, praise God, we got the raise, praise God, we got the house, praise God, we kept the baby, praise God, we got the land, praise God, uses the unlikely to do the impossible. God uses the unqualified and then qualifies us along the way. Come on, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God doesn't just always use the brightest and the best and the most impressive people all the time to accomplish God's work. It's not just about titles or diplomas or family history or heritage or race. It is about the Lord who has a way of helping you to reclaim your time. Paul speaks of redeeming the time to the church at Ephesus. The Greek word that is translated as redeemed means to make the most of. Hallelujah. It means to save from being wasted. That's what reclaiming your time is. It means that you are going to make the most of whatever opportunity God brings in your way. It means that every season is not a wasted season, not a wasted moment, not a wasted opportunity, no matter how hard or how harsh. In another translation, it means to use the present opportunity to the fullest. That's why I just love Maxine Waters. That's exactly what she was doing that day.
Yes, she was.
She was making the most of the opportunity, and she was not going to let anybody mess with her opportunity. She was not going to let anybody waste the time that she had. And we need to have some more Maxine Waters in this room who are bad and bold enough to say, I'm not going to let you waste my time. I'm not going to let you waste up my opportunity.
Yeah.
But I'm going to reclaim my time. Reclaiming my time is taking advantage of the opportunity which God gives you, because the Lord has a way of turning things around. The unlikely shepherd David wasn't a military strategist, yet he handled Goliath. Joseph, the baby of the family, was the unlikely to be second in command of Pharaoh, but he was. The woman at the well was the unlikely preacher and revival starter, but she was. Mary, the unlikely witness at the tomb early, that fateful moment. Peter, who denied Jesus three times, was unlikely to preach his trial sermon where 3,000 were saved. Wilma Rudolph couldn't walk or run as a child, the unlikely person to win an Olympic gold medal. Oprah Winfrey was molested as a child, pregnant at 14, the unlikely candidate to become a billionaire. Ursula Burns was raised in public housing by a single mother, the unlikely person to become the CEO of Xerox. Ron LaFleur was incarcerated, jail time, for what he did, the most unlikely candidate to go and